Malik Al-Zaghal, who is just to my right here, is the Prince Al-Walid bin Talal Professor of Contemporary Islamic Thought and Life in the Near Eastern Languages and Civilizations Department at Harvard. She's a political scientist, and she's going to talk to us about Tunisia. Tariq Masood, who is right next to her, is Associate Professor of Public Policy at the Harvard Kennedy School. Tariq is also a political scientist, and he is going to talk about Egypt. Incidentally, both Tariq and Malika were named Carnegie Scholars for their outstanding scholarship on Islam and the modern world. And Roger Owen, to my far right there, is the A.J. Meyer Professor of History at Harvard, recently emeritus. Last year, he published a highly relevant and timely book, The Rise and Fall of Arab Presidents for Life, from Harvard University Press. He got ahead of market there. And he's going to discuss events, as only he can, east of Suez. I'm going to lead off with an overview of the Arab Spring, followed by Professor Zaghal, Masood, and Owen in that order, and then we'll open up to questions and comments. Because the Arab Spring is still a work in progress, all we can do is explain how it got to where it is today, and then try to peer a bit into the future. But there is no science of prediction, at least when it comes to the Middle East. I'm an historian, and you know what they have to say about historians. We have enough trouble predicting the past, let alone the future. How were so many Arab regimes able to impose their authority over their citizens for four decades? Those autocrats who had it used their oil wealth to purchase the social peace. Others adopted neoliberal economic policies to attract Western foreign aid and used this aid in part to bind certain elites to their regimes through various forms of crony capitalism. And these regimes all used the repressive arm of the state to beat back all challengers. In so doing, they systematically denied most of their citizens their basic human rights and dignity. And in the process, they helped to create deeply disturbed societies. Their failure to create significant prosperity for the many, as they steadily unfastened the social safety nets on which the many counted on to survive, certainly contributed to the eruptions that began in December 2010. Also working against these regimes were mounting demographic pressures and escalating food prices. 60% of the Arab world is under the age of 30, and it is the young people who suffer the highest rates of unemployment, some of the same young people who went to the streets in Tunis and Cairo and elsewhere. Still, historians will be debating for years to come the question of why the uprisings didn't occur much earlier than just 2 years ago. It really is a paradox, that of highly unpopular regimes successfully imposing decades of relative stability over such deeply disturbed societies. What observations can we make about these uprisings, these revolutions, the likes of which have not been witnessed anywhere since the collapse of the Soviet Union and Eastern Bloc regimes more than two decades ago? Well, first, they were not ignited by the military or by foreign interventions. And nor were they led by revolutionaries with a clear vision or program. They were led by young, educated, mainly secular, urban middle-class elements who employed a language that spoke of a profound need to assert their human dignity. By rising up, they were announcing to their rulers and to the world that they had had enough. Second, Islamic organizations like the Muslim Brotherhood joined the protests late. The Islamists waited to see which way the winds were blowing and then jumped in. They appear to be reaping the benefits of uprisings, revolutions they didn't initiate. Third, while the uprisings in Tunisia and Egypt were not particularly violent, and both regimes fell quickly thanks to the army's support of the protesters, those uprisings that came after quickly became very violent and took or are taking much longer to resolve themselves, at least with regard to ousting their dictators. I'm thinking, of course, of Libya, and we're all watching Syria. The UCLA historian Jim Gelvin has conveniently grouped the Arab Spring into four categories or types, and I will follow his mapping because it is useful. The first grouping is Tunisia and Egypt. Both had armies that were able to step into crisis situations without fragmenting, and in the process, they helped to oust Ben Ali and Mubarak. Interestingly, after these leaders were ousted, Both Tunisia and Egypt saw Islamist parties with quite similar dispositions come to power in basically free elections. The second grouping is Yemen and Libya. Here, both regimes fragmented. Some of the army, some of the ranking government officials, some of the tribes stood by the regimes, while others from these very same elements joined the opposition. Neither had unified armies, and their autocrats hadn't built up sufficiently strong institutions, preferring to run the state as personal fiefdoms. Of course, the overthrow of the Libyan leader Gaddafi in October 2011 would have taken even longer had it not been for NATO's airstrikes. The third grouping are Syria and Bahrain. They are each family regimes that exploit ties of religious sect and kinship to reinforce their rule. The Alawite minority in Syria, which includes the Assad family, are an esoteric sect associated with Shiite Islam. The Alawites prop up the Assad regime. Meanwhile, the Syrian rebels are mainly Sunni Arabs, and they are a majority in that country. The longer the Syrian uprising continues, the more it is becoming a sectarian civil war between Sunni rebels and the Alawite-backed Assad regime. In Bahrain, Shiites are actually the majority, but they are also less economically advantaged than the Sunni minority and have the deepest grievances against the monarchy. The monarchy is an extended family bound by kinship ties, and it is Sunni. To ensure that the Bahraini monarchy didn't fall and possibly trigger a wave of protests across the Gulf region, Saudi Arabia's military rushed to the monarchy's rescue and crushed the dissident movement, at least for a while. There is yet a fourth grouping of Arab countries, all monarchies, where the protesters have been pressing for reforms rather than the overthrow of their monarchies. Jordan, Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, and Oman. There's a lot of speculation about why the Arab monarchies have fared considerably better than the Arab republics. Certainly, their vast oil wealth is buying time for some monarchies. But others don't have that kind of wealth, in particular Morocco and Jordan. And Jordan may be particularly vulnerable. Perhaps the monarchies haven't faced the kind of uprisings the Arab republics have because they can claim a dynastic or religious legitimacy that the republics cannot similarly claim. I'm not prepared to say, however, that some of the oil-rich Gulf countries will not face problems similar to what Bahrain is facing. One should watch, I think at this time, Kuwait in particular. It is now quite clear that the Arab future will not be decided by those who launched the Arab Spring. The secular liberal young people who first rose up and who demonstrated tremendous courage in challenging the legitimacy of their autocratic regimes just don't have the organizational strength and influence to contend with the Islamists. And let's face it, the language and the creed of the Islamists are very attractive to large numbers in the Arab world. The Islamists spent two generations honing their skills and developing their programs under repressive regimes. And so they've had extensive experience in opposition. But the Islamist parties that have won elections since the uprisings have had almost no experience in governing. They may understand social welfare, but their knowledge of modern economics is flimsy at best. Still, the Islamist parties that have won the highest offices in the land will now do everything they can to retain these offices, almost whatever the price. They do face challengers, the Islamists. One challenger is the military. The army may be back in its barracks now, but it has the power to intervene if there's long-term instability or if it feels that its financial interests are in jeopardy. In Egypt, the military is truly corporate and controls maybe a third of the formal economy. Another challenger is what is being called, for want of a better term, the Arab street. There are now Tahrir squares all over the Arab world where large protests occur almost daily. These permanent protesters are a mishmash of shifting coalitions of secular liberals, Islamists, religious minorities, women's and labor organizations, and others. And while they're hardly unified, they are definitely accusing the Islamic parties now in control of the highest government offices of trying to subvert the democratic processes that have been introduced these past 2 years. The Arab street has become an increasingly loud voice after 40 years of haunting silence. And not only in Tunisia and Egypt. One can see the street at work in Iraq, in Jordan, Bahrain, Kuwait, and elsewhere. The third challenger the Islamic ruling parties face, in a sense, comes from within their own ranks. I refer to the more militant, more purist, less compromising Islamic elements who are already nipping at their heels and mainly associated with the Salafis. The internal struggle among Islamists is already playing out in Cairo and Tunis and also within the rebel movements fighting to unseat the Assad regime in Syria and elsewhere too. I'd suggest that the longer the Islamic parties manage to control government, the more likely they'll be to consolidate their rule, a new kind of authoritarian rule, at the expense of most challengers. Syria. Everyone is watching the Syrian civil war unfold. In 2 years, in a country of 23 million, more than 70,000 have been killed. That's the equivalent of nearly 1 million Americans. There are already more than 2 million internal refugees, and nearly 1 million more refugees have flooded into neighboring countries, maybe as many as 400,000 already into fragile Lebanon. Meanwhile, the middle classes and the Christian minorities are fleeing in droves from Syria, and the battle for Damascus is just beginning. Why is Syria so critical? Because events in that country could cause and are already causing perturbations in Syria's immediate neighbors. And meanwhile, there is Iran, which is witnessing the demise of its closest ally in the Arab world, the Assad regime. In simple terms, there is a proxy war going on. On one side, we have Iran, along with Russia, supporting the Alawite-backed Assad regime, while Saudi Arabia and Qatar assist the rebels who are trying to topple the regime. And Washington comes down on their side. The longer the civil war continues, the better the chance that more militant Islamic forces will gain the upper hand in the hotly contested struggles among the Syrian opposition for who will one day replace the Assad regime. There's growing speculation that Syria could collapse into 3 or 4 separate enclaves, but I doubt any could survive economically for very long. Israel is watching Syria very closely, in case the regime starts using its chemical weapons. And Israel is tracking Hezbollah's movements in Lebanon. Hezbollah is the radical Lebanese Shiite party that has gone head-to-head militarily with Israel in the past. Its fate is tied to the Syrian regime, which has been the funnel through which Iranian weapons and aid reach Hezbollah in Lebanon. And if the Syrian regime topples, Hezbollah could become quiet, go underground for a while, or in an act of desperation, it might try to take over the Lebanese government militarily, which would likely provoke Israel. At the least, Hezbollah will become increasingly involved in the armed skirmishes between pro-Syrian Lebanese factions and the Lebanese aligned with the Syrian rebels. Add the enormous refugee problem to the mix, and Lebanon could possibly begin to unravel as it did during the long civil war of the 70s and 80s. Meanwhile, the Turks are nervously engaged because they want to make sure the Syrian Kurdish minority on Turkey's borders doesn't cause disruptions that spill over into Turkey and arouse its own disenfranchised Kurdish minority. And Turkey wants to influence whatever replaces the Assad regime when it collapses. Finally, the Obama administration so far has refused to encourage the delivery of major weapon systems to the Syrian rebels because it worries that they may fall into the hands of those extremist rebel forces most committed to terrorism. 2 weeks ago, we did start to provide funding to go for so-called non-lethal aid, medical supplies, and food. And Washington may well be supporting the training of Syrian rebels in Jordan. Washington would like to persuade the Russians to back a transitional government through the UN Security Council, but so far there hasn't been much traction there. The US is generally facing a reduction in its ability to influence events and trends in the Arab world. We've lost our allies in Tunisia, Egypt, and Yemen, and we haven't really gained new ones in those places, though we're working at it. U.S. policy will continue to focus on finding ways to stabilize the region so as to ensure the flow of oil and to prevent regional warfare between the usual and the not-so-usual suspects. My main point is that Washington's leverage has been diminished, and Mr. Obama apparently has learned from Afghanistan and Iraq that if we aren't careful, Syria could suck us into a situation from which we may not be able to extract ourselves anytime soon. Washington will continue to escalate its diplomatic initiatives with the aim of trying to ensure that when the Assad regime tumbles, it doesn't tumble into the wrong hands. And whether our administration will also undertake substantive new initiatives toward a solution to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict amidst all else is something we're all going to be watching and have started to watch very closely in the week or two ahead as Mr. Obama goes to Israel. I wouldn't be too hopeful. Okay, that's a view of the Arab Spring, say, from 30,000 feet. Let me now turn to our colleagues. They're going to give us more fine-grained analyses of different components of the Arab Spring. And I think, Malika, if we start with you, please. Thank you.